So when you take a look at melanoma, the key in melanoma is detecting it early. And even the subtle changes. So the most important thing is that if you have a history of melanoma, or your family members have to be looking at subtle changes that occur in a mole. And everyone will talk about the ABCDs. You know, they'll talk about the asymmetry, the border irregularity, the color, the diameter, and the slow change that may happen. And you can take a look at slides where they show this, where they show that, look, this is what asymmetry looks like. This is what border irregularity looks like. This is what color and evolution, all these changes look like. But the most important take-home message today is look for the ugly duckling. Look for the starry star. You look at your moles all the time. Anything that sticks out, anything you think has changed, anything that looks different, that's the mole you want to take. So if the color changes, the texture changes, it starts bleeding, it becomes scaly, it's important that you take that in to see your family doctor just for the initial evaluation. So why does melanoma happen, right? What happens? There's no doubt that there are, in some families, a genetic tendency for melanoma to happen. But sun exposure plays the biggest role. And so what kind of sun exposure? And I essentially feel that there's two points. One is exposure as a child. And this is where I think you get the melanomas of the back of your legs and the back of your chest, and areas that are usually exposed when you're an adult. Those are caused by early sun exposure. The sun causes significant changes basically in the DNA, which over time leads to unregulated growth of those melanocytes. The second form of sun exposure is sun exposure you get as an adult. And this is the kind of melanoma I think you get on the back of your hands and on your face, your chest, and your upper back. But when it comes to sun, these are things I still can't believe I'm hearing. I'm just getting a base tan. The main thing is there's no such thing as a safe tan, right? Two kinds of sun rays, UVB and UVA. So UVB burns you. And believe it or not, that's kind of a protective mechanism in your body, because you're out there, you burn, you come back in again, right? UVA doesn't burn you. It will tan you and will give you a base tan. Trouble is, UVA is dangerous as well. It causes changes, maybe less than UVB, but it still causes changes in your skin. And the scary thing about UVA, it actually penetrates in deeper than UVB. So you have to be careful when you go to a tanning booth and you say, well, just get a base tan. I go tanning to ensure enough, I get enough vitamin D. You know, in Canada, the sun comes out, we all flock out there, right? We're all gonna get vitamin D. The main thing is you don't go crazy. Enjoy yourself, enjoy your summers, right? So how do you do that? Wear protective clothing if you have a high risk, right? Wear sunscreen, but seek shade. So I'm not saying don't go out and sit on a patio, but you can sit on a patio and be underneath an umbrella at the same time. You can sit by a pool and be underneath an umbrella at the same time. You know, we can't live in fear of everything. We've got to live our lives. And we'll get enough vitamin D while we're doing that, because it will still come through. Tanning beds are safer than sun rays? Well, discuss that. Don't even think about it. All you're going to do is increase your risk of skin cancer, and you're going to age dramatically. I see this all day long. I see beautiful young women in their 30s coming in, looking like they're 70-year-old Florida women, with the wrinkles developing that are deep. It's dramatic aging, what tanning does. I heard sunscreen causes cancer. Right, there is no proven study to show that sunscreen actually causes cancer. The only concern I have is when you have sunscreen on, you're not burning. If you're not burning, you're not getting that protective effect. If you're not getting that protective effect, you get an increase in the amount of UVA gone. So again, be sun smart. Put your sunscreen on, enjoy your summer, seek shade, look at the times that you go out. Maybe you don't want to go out and play golf at 12 o'clock. Maybe go at 4. The sun rays are less intense at that point. I hear nothing over SPF 30 works anyway. And SPF basically refers to UVB protection, right? So most sunscreens you want to take a look at should have both UVB and UVA protection. And you have a great sponsor here with a great sunscreen, Anti-Helio 60, which in my opinion for your whole body for true protection is one of the best sunscreens on the market. So it's not just the SPF factor, but look for broad spectrum and make sure that it has UVA protection as well. The one thing I suggest to my patients is, look, most women put on a moisturizer anyway. Most guys should be putting something on. So take something that looks good on your skin, doesn't look pasty, leave it in the shower, right? Almost everyone in this room takes a shower in the morning. As soon as you've taken your shower, towel dry, and on your face, neck, and if you're balding on your scalp in men, and on the back of your hands, put on a sunscreen 365 days of the year, right? At least it will try and stop the one kind of melanoma that comes from late sun exposure. The other thing it'll do will make your skin look better, and you'll age less dramatically, right? And that's one simple solution. When you're out in the sun and you go out in the sun, definitely put your sunscreen on. The trouble is, what happens in this country when you do have a change, right? So when you have a change in your mole and you've detected that change, you'll go see your family doctor. And your family doctor will make a decision. If they're absolutely convinced it's a melanoma, they'll probably try and get you to see a plastic surgeon as soon as possible, which is almost impossible unless you're 3 or 4 months down the line, right? It's usually easier to get in to see a dermatologist, and if not, and you're worried, push. The family doctor can make a call, and the dermatologist will see you within a day or two. We don't know who needs to see us straight away, but if there's a worry and there's a change and you're really concerned, just ask your family doctor to call, and the dermatologist will usually see you the same day. So when you see the dermatologist, what do? They'll take a look at the mole, right? So we see moles all day long. And we quickly go through the ABCDs. We're not like looking, is it symmetrical? Your brain just does it. There's a gestalt. There's just a sense. Just like when you take a look at an elephant, you know it's an elephant. You don't have to say there's a tusk, there's a trunk. If we're unsure, we'll do something called a dermatoscope, which is basically a magnifying glass. And it'll let us know, you know, you can see some things that will be totally benign, some things will look like basal cells, and some things that will be suspicious of melanoma. If we're still not sure, we'll do a biopsy. And a biopsy is a great thing to do. It gives you a definitive answer. And that's important, right? I mean, there is a low risk that a pathologist can be wrong, but it's only 1% or 2% or even less than that when it comes to melanoma. But there's problems with a biopsy too. There's a risk of scarring, infection, and you can only biopsy 1 or 2 lesions at a time. And there's always that anxiety associated with a 2-week wait. But this is still the gold standard. This is still every dermatologist's go-to, right? So this is still what has to be done when you're really suspicious of a melanoma. You better biopsy that lesion and get an answer. This is the most important thing that has to be done. But the trouble in Canada is there's a severe shortage of dermatologists. This will change over the next 10 or 15 years. We have pushed the government. The government is producing more dermatologists, but there's only one problem. They never leave the cities where they get trained in. So they're stuck in Toronto, they're stuck in Ottawa. Now you'd think Oakville is Toronto, but you know, there's a dermatologist for every 20,000 people in Toronto, there's a dermatologist for 1 in 68,000 people in Oakville, right? They just don't want to come this far out. Why? I don't know. Oakville, I think, is a great city to live in, you know? So what other options are we looking at? One of the things that I think most dermatologists should be doing is mole mapping. Not in every patient, right? So if you have a lot of moles on you, and there's a family history, a personal history of melanoma, that I personally feel, and statistics show this, you had a greater risk for melanoma. So in the olden days, we'd bring you in every week, every month, once a year, and we'd strip you down, take a look at you. Then we started photographing you. But there are now mole mapping systems out there. There's MoleMax, MoleMap, PhotoFinders, which is what we use in our office. And essentially what happens is you come in, we take pictures of you, you come back every 6 months to a year, depending on your risk group, we take photos of you, and the computer will tell us if any mole has changed, right? And then if it's changed, we can use a dermatoscope, or what we do is nowadays use something called a Verisanti Aura Laser. So what is a Verisanti Aura Laser, right? Essentially what it is a machine that can detect the difference in biochemistry between a cancer cell and a non-cancer cell. And it has a 99% sensitivity, right? So there's 99% chance that I'm not going to miss a cancer, which is very important. So it makes it almost better than my eyes when I see a patient. The advantage is that it's basically fast and it's rapid. Within 20 seconds, I can look at a lesion and tell you whether it's anything to worry about, right? It reduces anxiety really fast. If the machine tells me it's benign, you know that right away. We're not waiting 2 weeks to find out if it's benign or not. There's no risk of scarring. But where I really find it helpful is in that person with multiple lesions. I mean, if it's only one lesion and I'm suspecting it, it's easy for me to biopsy it. If it's in an area where a scar doesn't matter. But if it's on a face, I'd rather do Verisanti or a laser to find out. If it's on a chest, where you may get a scar, I do Verisanti or a laser. Where it really becomes advantageous is, let's say there's 10 or 15 lesions, all of which look a little funny. We know they all can't be melanoma, but is any of them a melanoma? So I can scan 10 or 15 lesions quite rapidly. The main drawback of it is the way we set the machine, because we do not want to miss a melanoma, there is a higher false positive rate. Well, there's a false positive rate for me as a dermatologist anyway. If you take a look at it, I biopsy a lot of lesions looking for one melanoma, because I do not want to miss that melanoma. So this is a serious, serious cancer. And I think two things are happening with melanoma. First of all, there is early detection means almost a cure. As I said before, you detect it early, you're a cure. I think the combination of mole mapping and aura laser is going to be very helpful in not missing any melanomas. And I have a big push with dermatologists saying this should be available in every dermatologist's office and not only in two sites in the whole of Canada, here and one site on the West Coast. The second thing, thankfully, is for metastatic melanoma, as you have known, and the Melanoma Network will tell you, there are newer gene therapies and newer immunotherapies that are very helpful in increasing life expectancy and basically giving you almost a remission in certain cases, especially with combination therapy. And that's all I have to say, guys. Thank you for having me. I'll take any comments.